Okay?
Yeah, we're sexy.
Welcome to the show. It's Thursday the 12th. I'm Rich Masotti.
And I'm Guy Monica. Hey, you gotta love Bob Ezrin's kids there in the beginning there.
Oh, like, totally. Yeah. Kiss, God of Thunder, Destroyer 1976. God of Thunder, right? Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Bob Ezrin's kids in the studio screwing around in the background, and they kept it.
Absolutely. And it was perfect, you know, just it was imperfectly perfect.
God bless you. We're happy to have you here. It's good to be back. It's been a little while. We're excited about relaunching this podcast, and we are now officially known as Thursday the 12th, and you can follow us on all of your social media with similar handles there. What are you looking at there, Jerky? You reading them?
Just making sure that we've got them all written down, and we don't want to forget anything.
What do we have so far?
Well, you can get us at Thursday the 12th podcast at gmail.com. There is also the Thursday the 12th podcast at Instagram.
And we have for you Twitter fans at Thursday the 12th. That's a little different. At Thursday the 12th. And when we say 12, we are always using the numerals, the numbers 1, 2, 12. We're not spelling out the word. And finally, of course, facebook.com/groups/Thursday the 12th. So one more time, Thursday the 12th podcast at gmail.com, the Thursday the 12th podcast on Instagram.
At Thursday the 12th, that's the numeral 1, 2, at for our Twitter handle, and Facebook, FB, facebook.com/groups/ThursdayThe12th with the TH.
And we're very excited. By the time you hear this, we have new artwork that has been revealed. Give you another look at some insight into what makes us tick, the flavor of our show, which of course will not be all entirely music. It will not be all entirely horror movies. There will be current events.
Oh, really? Oh, wait a minute.
Oh, I'm sorry. No. You might have signed up for the wrong show.
No, of course, yes. Yeah, no, of course.
No, we've been around for a while, and we've covered a number of topics, but we tend to gravitate back towards some. And we're here to tell you we're still going to do that, only with a broader scope for those of you who know us or don't know us but want to be entertained without necessarily being pigeonholed into, certain corners, okay? Yeah. So, For starters, it's the holiday season. It's late 2018. The relaunch is officially scheduled for January 1st, 2019, and our production schedule will be such that you can now expect a brand new episode from us every Thursday. Now, if we happen to have a Thursday the 12th in a given month, there will be an extra special episode lined up for you. And anytime there is a Thursday the 12th in a month,
it is almost always, no, it is always, in fact, followed by our, what would you call it?
Well, it's certainly one of my favorite holidays.
It's a lot like our Christmas, if you will, that being the Friday the 13th of a given month.
Yes. With all due respect, I love Christmas, so I don't know about all that, all right? But Friday the 13th is on a list with Christmas for me.
Oh, absolutely.
Okay.
And I'll tell you what, Thursday the 12th is on that same list for me because Christmas Eve has always been something very special for me, too.
Oh, yeah. How nice. That's all you had on that, yeah. Really?
Well, you know,
I was waiting for the connection.
Well, no, just being that it's the eve of said holiday.
Well, come on. Christmas Eve is awesome, as is Christmas Day. That's okay. That goes without saying. But yes, so Thursday the 12th is the eve of what some consider a very unlucky day. Of course, we don't. Oh. We love it. And the films that wear its name.
Exactly. I couldn't have said that better myself.
I don't know if I said it well at all, but we will not be spending. Let's tell them all the things we will not be spending all our time on, Johnny.
Yeah, we will not be spending our time on stuff that we don't want to talk about, basically, you know?
There you go. Very good. And we didn't start with that whole, and we are here to you.
That's okay.
And now
right.
I mentioned it.
It's all right. Nothing wrong with that.
Okay, you sure? Keep talking, because right. I don't like it.
Perfect. Good.
Well, I don't like it.
You see? We're off to a bad start already.
Yeah, we are. We're going to stop and rewind and start all over again.
Again?
You ready?
And again.
Welcome to the show. And I say welcome to the show. Hey, it's Thursday the 12th. I'm Rich Masotti.
And I'm Guy Monica.
And we're here to fuck you up. Okay, welcome back, everybody, and thanks for tuning in. It has been a while. No, we're not going to really do that all over again.
No.
Okay, so as I said, it's December. It's almost the new year. You can count on us every Thursday in January and going forward, but 'tis the season. The holidays are upon us. Christmas, New Year's, Christmas Eve, all that good stuff.
Kwanzaa.
Kwanzaa, and yeah, right, thanks. but it's also almost award season, so nominations have been dropping, right? That's all in the news. The Grammy nominations, the Golden Globes,
SAG Awards, I want to say.
Have they?
I believe so.
I'm not sure, but no Oscars yet.
No, not yet. No, I know for sure. I saw something with SAG because
that's right.
Say it. One picture that came out this year that I have become incredibly fond of, A Star Is Born.
Ah,
Bradley Cooper's reimagining and redoing of the film has absolutely captivated me. And I did come across something on one of the social media platforms that had some SAG nominations for that film.
Absolutely. You probably will hear us talk a lot about A Star Is Born, but they're up for Golden Globes. I think you're right. They're up for SAG Awards. They've already won some awards. I don't remember the names of those organizations, but we're talking about nominations for Bradley Cooper's acting, his directing, Lady Gaga's acting, the music in the film, Sam Elliott as a supporting actor.
Yeah, all of it, all of it.
Top to bottom. You know, I'm not always a, you know, a believe the hype kind of go out and see the movie everybody's talking about kind of guy. But this film is must see.
Indeed.
And the few people I've spoken to who don't love it can go fuck themselves, really, right?
Well, you know, to be honest, yeah. I couldn't have said that better.
All right,
either.
Yeah, sorry. To go right there with the F-bombs.
That's
I was going to leave that to you.
Nah, it's all right, whatever. Me, you, whoever.
All right, I'm going to leave the F-bombs to Guy from now on.
Fair enough.
But you must see it. It was beautifully done, written, performed, executed, directed. Fantastic. So they've got some nominations coming up, and at the Grammys as well.
Oh, absolutely.
Right? Yeah. How sick would it be if Gaga wins a Grammy and an Oscar and a Golden Globe for that song?
You know, as crazy as that sounds, it is completely possible, borderline probable.
Right, right.
You know? I mean, it's just incredible.
Unless, of course, these organizations have something against Italian women this year.
And that is always a possibility.
All right. Also in the movies recently, we saw a picture that probably should have been nominated. At least the male lead should have been nominated. Mr. Matt Dillon from Amerenek, New York, originally, has a new film out called The House That Jack Built. Mm. We saw a director's cut, uncut, unedited, and not meant to be played in theaters a few weeks ago. And we needed to sit through that just to get over the shock value and see what all, again, see what all the hype was about, right? Because this played at Cannes or something, and half the place stood up and applauded, and half the place walked out.
Right, yeah, right? Exactly.
So we had to sit through this director's cut to really just sort of get it out of our system. But we went back and saw the rated R,
the rated version.
Theatrical release.
Yeah.
And it was a good film.
Oh, it was incredible.
Do you remember the director's name?
It escapes me at the moment, and I feel horrible.
Von Trier? Von Trier?
Von Trapp. I honestly, something along those lines. Whatever the gentleman's name is, what a fantastic job he did.
Well, he's controversial in his own right.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
I don't know what he's done or said in the past. I think he was banned from Cannes or somewhere
something
for several years because he made some Nazi references. I'm not down with any of that. I don't know his background or his history. I'm not here to I'm not here to toot his horn by any means. But this was a well-made film, and more importantly, Matt Dillon gave possibly the performance of his career.
In my personal opinion, and not that I'm the most, tremendous Matt Dillon fan, I am a fan of his, and I do like a lot of the stuff he's done. This, by a good measure, was the best performance I've ever seen him put on the screen.
Okay. And I've been, following him loosely ever since Over the Edge, back in, the late 70s when HBO first hit TV. Over the Edge, if you're in our age group, you know it, you remember it, you love it. I wasn't a huge Matt Dillon fan over the years, but fast forward to Crash, and Crash is where he made his modern comeback.
Yeah,
and he's been doing some wonderful work ever since, and this is no exception. Now it's a twisted film. He plays a psycho killer. A serial killer. He plays a serial killer. There is some stuff that takes place in the film that's hard to watch, but his performance was beautiful. And maybe we'll leave it there. We saw it at the Alamo on Central Avenue in what was it?
Yonkers.
Yeah. We saw it there twice. We're big fans of the Alamo Draft House. They play a lot of old, a lot of new, a lot of borrowed, a lot of blue,
a lot of non-rated versions, director's cut that we saw of this film.
The occasional indie, unrated director's cuts, the versions you never saw, a lot of 35 millimeter rather than digital.
Mm-hmm.
They often have people come in for Q&A and autograph signings and things of that nature. Great place to sit, enjoy a movie, and have service at your seat. You know, eat some bottomless popcorn.
Absolutely.
All that good stuff. A lot of fun. Check online to see if there's an Alamo Draft House near you. Those who are local to us know that we're big fans of the location on Central Avenue in Yonkers. And if Komisikyam, Justin La Liberty is listening, or Matt, what the hell was Matt's name?
Matt's last name escapes me. I'm sorry, Matt.
Fudge. Yeah, sorry, Matt. Anyway, they're good guys, and they're usually really quick to take care of people if you have any questions, complaints, or compliments.
Yes.
And you'll probably have some complaints, but we love them anyway.
That's right.
All right, so what else? Plenty on the horizon. You know, we're going to have all kinds of blockbusters coming out, fighting for the Christmas crowd at the box office.
Mm-hmm.
Can't tell you what any of those are right now, but they're coming. We can tell you that Kiss is about to embark on their final end of the road world tour. Dream Theater has a new album dropping in February, and they'll be touring to support that in the spring. We're looking forward to both of those shows, and we will have plenty to tell you about some very exciting recent developments where Kiss's End of the Road tour is concerned.
Oh, absolutely.
Stay tuned for that.
Can't wait for that.
Absolutely. So what else? What else is on your mind right now?
Well, you know, yeah, we'll be talking about, you know, film, music. We'll even go into maybe some wrestling.
Yes, we will.
We're both of us are tremendous wrestling fans.
Yes, we will.
Right,
last night was WWE's TLC pay-per-view.
Sure.
We're about to head into the road to WrestleMania, which means next month is the Royal Rumble.
That's right.
February will be maybe the Elimination Chamber. April will be WrestleMania 35.
Mm-hmm.
35. I started watching right after the original WrestleMania took place in 1985. Not that I started watching right after. I was probably watching, but my mother purchased the first WrestleMania for me.
On VHS?
On VHS.
Okay.
I don't think I began watching the pay-per-views at home until closer to WrestleMania 3.
Okay.
But I was watching in 84, 85, and I've been watching ever since. And 35th WrestleMania, right here from New York, New Jersey, at Giant Stadium.
MetLife Stadium, whatever they're calling it nowadays. Yeah.
It should be huge.
It should be tremendous.
So you'll be hearing plenty about that. Our travels to Florida, our travels to Rise Above Floatation in Mount Kisco, where we get our float on.
Love that place.
Oh, my Lord. In fact, we were up there today, and you'll be hearing plenty about them very soon. maybe even the McDonald's in Mount Kisco down the street from Rise Above Floatation.
Award-winning, folks.
All right, listen. We don't recommend that you go out and eat McDonald's.
Ever.
And ever. Don't do it.
However.
However. And they're not a sponsor here yet. But and I'm not sure we'd take their money, would we? Sure, why not?
You know what? If we wouldn't take their money, we would certainly take gratuities in the form of sustenance.
Oh, sustenance, which we don't recommend you participate in. However, the McDonald's in Mount Kisco.
That's right.
You said that was going to happen. Ketaco, the McDonald's in Mount Kisco is, I think, the best McDonald's ever.
Well, it's
this side of Florida.
It's without question the best that I've ever eaten at. Yeah. They do it right. They do it right. If Ray Kroc were here, God bless him, he'd be nodding his head in approval with a nice grin on his face, I'm sure.
Was that his name?
Yeah.
And what was the name of that movie again?
The Founder, I believe.
The Founder.
Michael Keaton.
Oh, yeah. Yes. The Founder.
Which, you know, that movie came and went, and I didn't get to see it.
I don't know. I heard it was good.
Right? The trailer looked good. We saw the trailer. Whatever. At any rate.
I don't know.
Whatever. At any rate, McDonald's and Mount Kisco.
Your burgers are fresh and juicy.
Oh,
and not just, and it, apparently not just the Quarter Pounders either. Because they got this whole new gimmick where you get your hot, fresh, new, juicy, you know, real meat kind of quarter pounder thing. I had a triple cheeseburger that was still pretty darn fresh.
Nice.
But your burger most recently was pink and juicy.
Let me tell you.
I mean, for a second there, I wasn't sure we were talking about McDonald's anymore.
If I took those patties and put them on a different bun and we were eating them at home, you would have thought I grilled them chips on my own grill.
God bless them. The team over there is great. All business. Clean lobby. You know, you might not want to go to the counter for any help. You might want to use the kiosk.
True.
But aside from, you know, having to maybe stand at the counter for a few minutes before anybody acknowledges you, the rest of it is top-notch.
That's it.
Okay.
So, in summation, don't eat McDonald's.
That's right.
But, yeah. All right. Are we still... Oh, you're still going. Good.
I was going to... No, insert the...
Yeah, yeah.
That was 20 minutes.
Yeah. Insert your spot there. Yeah.
On me.
Hey, it's Rich. Have you heard about flotation therapy? It's also known as sensory deprivation. Well, Rise Above Floatation is Westchester County, New York's first and only flotation center. Based on the science of sensory deprivation for deep relaxation and exceptional awareness, Rise Above Floatation features three float-away sensory deprivation tanks designed by Colin Smith, the chief engineer of Rolls-Royce and co-inventor of the Concorde supersonic passenger jet. Call 914-241-1900 or visit riseabovefloatation.com for more information. Rise Above Floatation is located at 111 East Main Street in Mount Kisco, New York, and you can book your first float by visiting riseabovefloatation.com.
Turn the mic up, asswipe.
Shut up.
All right, leave it down. Rise Above Floatation is located at 111 East Main Street. That McDonald's might actually be considered Bedford. Or Bedford.
I don't care.
I know you don't. By visiting riseabovefloatation.com.
You know, I love that place.
Oh, it's the best. It really is.
Oh, but you know what I don't love? There are two things I don't love. During the break, you were trying to tell me that McDonald's might actually be Bedford, not Mount Kisco.
I'm not certain, but that is going toward Bedford, and some of those addresses over there are considered Bedford Hills.
Oh, Christ.
Whatever.
All right.
If you're in Mount Kisco, there's only one McDonald's around here, and it's the one on...
Yeah, whatever street that is with all the shopping.
Yeah,
you know what the other thing is that I don't like?
What's that?
Eddie Trunk.
That fucking guy.
Yeah. Yeah, I know. You know who he is, and I barely know who he is, but I can't stand him. My first real interaction with him, now don't get me wrong, I've heard a little bit of his stuff here and a little bit of his stuff there, very little. I get that the guy's been on the air for a long time. He's probably helped some up-and-coming and unsigned acts.
Sure, yeah.
He knows his rock and metal, I guess. Was that his thing, metal, initially?
He hosts that metal show on
VH1.
Oh,
it is the metal. Oh,
yeah,
I
metal
don't know
show.
If that's on the air anymore.
Well, at any rate.
Was that originally a radio show?
I don't know.
Okay.
Honestly, I don't
know. I don't think it's on TV anymore. I could be wrong. I used to watch that once in a while in spite of him.
Mm.
Okay. So maybe I know the guy a little bit more than I thought. All right? But I'm not a fan. If you couldn't tell, I'm not a fan. Even though I appreciate he's made some kind of mark and probably has helped some people, all right? Some people, when they spend enough time doing something, whether they're good at it or not, make friends and can call in favors. I guess I'm burying myself here. The guy did something right, right?
Along the way, yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
I just don't agree with many of his opinions. Now, you would think I'd love this guy for one reason alone. Apparently, allegedly, he is or used to be a huge Kiss fan.
Yeah.
Okay? I don't know what happened, but my first real encounter with the man named Eddie Trunk was at a Saigon Kick show in April of 2017. So that's a year and a half ago, let's say. Okay? It wasn't the other day, but close enough.
Mm.
So we go down to the studio at Webster Hall in New York City to see Saigon Kick play. And there were two bands on before them, Shinobi Ninja and Midnight Mob.
Right.
Okay. Eddie apparently is friends with our favorite member of Saigon Kick, Mr. Jason Beeler.
And we will get more into Jason later on in subsequent episodes, but briefly... One of the greatest fucking guys. If you are ever lucky enough to meet the guy, one of the best guys you'll ever fucking get to know.
Oh, my God. Talk about humble and talented and I'm going to say handsome because we hope he's listening.
Absolutely.
Right? Humble and talented and handsome is Jason Beeler.
Sharp
but
dressed.
Oh, boy. He was in Saigon Kick back in the 90s, etc. And for my taste, for my money, he is Saigon Kick.
Absolutely.
With all due respect to the rest of those guys. But we went to see them reunited for a show in New York City last year. And Eddie Trunk was the host vis-a-vis this radio station and this show and however that works, right? So they call him out to the stage at some point. The club must have.
Yeah.
The club calls him out to the stage to introduce the main event, the headlining act. We had a few hundred people in attendance. And here's Saigon Kick, Matt Kramer, Jason Beeler, Chris McLernan, Stephen Gibb, and your boy Mover on the drums.
That's right, Jonathan Mover.
Jonathan Mover, right?
So thanks again for the sticks, Jonathan.
That's right. If you know, that's where we cut in. Hey, Jonathan, if you're listening, right? You can catch all of that in our library, in the archives, if you will.
That's right.
So it's not the original lineup, but good enough, right?
Absolutely.
Because Matt Kramer and Jason Beeler were back together, and the current lineup kicks ass.
Absolutely.
So Trunk goes out to the stage and begins to do probably less of an introduction than I just did. And we love you, Jason, so no offense, okay? I'm just not a fan of Trunk, okay? So he goes up to the stage. He makes an introduction. He calls out the band, right? Now, while he's on stage, what do you remember happening?
Well, there was another fan in attendance that, unbeknownst to us, at least at first, also was not the biggest fan of Mr. Trunk.
Now, you were at the time.
I wouldn't say I was the biggest fan. And
No, not the biggest, but a fan.
Somewhat of a fan.
I was not. You were.
Just to be a little more clear, I would say I was a fan, and maybe still am a fan, of his weekly syndicated radio program, and not even necessarily a fan of him and what he says and does on the show, but rather the playlist, the music that he chooses to play. On the station here in the New York metro area that he's on, you're going to hear tunes on his show that you're not normally going to hear on said station or even any other stations around, because there just aren't any really good heavy metal.
Even the station he's on doesn't necessarily play.
Correct.
Okay. Correct. I was going to say our music. It is. It's our music.
Right.
But, which makes it even more of a shame that I just can't get into the guy.
Yeah. I hear you on that.
All right. So I'm not a fan. You sort of are. And this, we start to hear like something going on while Eddie's up there at the mic, right? We start to hear some sort of rumbling in the crowd.
Some sort of a heckling going on.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah. Oh, perfect, heckling. Yeah. And I think initially this kid got a few boos because there were Eddie Trunk fans there.
Oh, sure.
Okay.
Yeah, and that's understandable. You know, right. I mean, you know, people are there, again, small venue, a lot of really diehard fans of the band, and people are there in support of the band and subsequently in support of whoever is on stage in support of the band, i.e. the host who's introducing them. So people who are getting ready to see this band they love aren't really into, you know, hearing some, you know, guy who's had a few too many beers or whatever giving the host all kinds of shit. Unless you happen to be people like us, who already have somewhat of a gripe against said host and are appreciative of said heckling.
Okay, right. And gripe would be a strong word.
Okay.
I didn't want to be bothered with him. I was there for Saigon Kick. But we start to hear some noise.
Worm.
And what do you recall about that?
Well, the kid was heckling him on something.
It was a name he kept saying.
He what about such and such?
Yeah.
And what about this? And what about that?
Right.
Like something must have been in the news, or maybe he had someone on one of his shows recently that was in the news.
Right.
That did something controversial. Ah, some shit. Whatever it was.
Right.
The kid was giving him the business.
And this kid had like an itch to specifically, I'm going to say, attack Eddie on this point.
Yeah.
Whatever it was. Somebody must have humiliated Eddie, or Eddie must have done someone wrong. Whatever it was, it seemed timely. We don't know the name. I don't remember it. We could make up a name, but like the kid began to approach the stage saying something like, hey, what about, what about that time? What about...
Comme
right? So we don't know, okay? So he's getting closer and closer to the stage, and then the banter becomes...
It's more like a, yeah, fuck you, Ed, fuck you, you suck, fuck you, fuck you, Eddie, suck my dick, fuck you!
Oh, my Lord, so he's just quoting somebody else folks.
That's quote-unquote, Amy, all right, that's quote-unquote, that's not me. That's it.
Right, so that's what happened. Now, at this point, I probably was hysterical and probably getting a kick out of it, right? And Eddie's paying him no mind at first, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. I think Eddie paid him no mind at first and just tried to go on with his business. And he made his introduction and yada, yada, yada. And we're getting a kick out of it at this point. We might have even been cheering the kid on.
Oh, I know I was. Right. Yes, I know. At that point, I know I was. Yeah, once I realized and heard the fuck yous and the you sucks, and I was all about it then. And we're like, yeah. Yeah, because if I'm not mistaken, earlier in the evening during the opening acts, this same fan that we're talking about, the same guy in the crowd, was acting a little obnoxious, a little rowdy. Again, he was probably inebriated in one way or another.
I don't recall that at all, and I hope you're not confusing him with the guy I sang with.
No. This is the guy who was giving him the finger, and yeah, no, absolutely.
And at first, he comes off like some butthead who's just trying to barge through the crowd.
Totally.
So we don't like that. But when he starts giving Eddie a hard time, okay, maybe we like that, right? Yeah. So his tune changes from just a, hey, what a, to a, you know, all that stuff Guy just said. and Eddie, for the most part, doesn't acknowledge him until the introduction is complete.
Right.
Now, when the introduction of Saigon Kick is complete and Eddie, you figure, is about to leave the stage, he instead... moves to the edge of the stage toward the audience, right? Mm-hmm. And he tries to get right in this kid's face. You know, correct me, am I wrong?
You are, to my recollection, you're painting the exact picture.
All right, so he gets right toward the edge of the stage, and now he's like practically in this kid's face. And he just like, I don't know if he says anything at first, but he throws his friggin' hand out. He extends his arm and tries to put his finger right back in that kid's face. I'm doing it. Mm. I'm doing it because it's the kind of thing I can recall having done in the past. You get so angry, you don't want to put hands on somebody. You don't have the balls for that. But you just like, ah, and you throw the, I mean, I've done this to your father once. I ever tell you that story?
No, I don't know.
We were at a party for Michelle, I think. We were at that party, that reception for Michelle, I think, at Giuliano's in New Rochelle.
Oh, really?
All right.
Where the fuck was I?
You weren't...
I was with you. Well, I mean, no, you when this happened, I wasn't there.
Why the hell? Why weren't you there?
I was at the party, but when this instance you're speaking of...
No, you weren't there. This must have been a different party.
Oh, then it was a different party.
It must have been a different party.
Of course I was there. I gave the speech.
Were you... Well, I was at this party with Liz.
Okay.
I was at this party with Liz.
Which?
We were hanging out with some of some your father's, yours, baseball stoner type friends.
All right.
We were at an unwanted table.
Right.
My father was there. Anyway, we were having some drinks, and at some point, I crossed the room to get a drink. You weren't present. And your father was near the bar, and your father said something I didn't like, and I had already had a few drinks in me, and I literally, come here, get closer. I literally was like, for some reason, just... like this, was like, yeah, yeah, you fucking deadbeat, right? I mean, he probably would have put me through a wall.
Where the fuck was I?
I listen.
And how do I not?
And I turn and look over my other shoulder, and my father was looking at me with disgust. Those were my disgust years.
Well, you know what? They may or may not have been your disgust years, but that moment, by no stretch of any imagination, where it was disgusting whatsoever, and you should not be ashamed whatsoever.
I'm ashamed because it is your father.
Well, I'm telling you as his son.
No. We're crossing lines now. We're crossing lines. Anyway, I'm sorry about that.
What a horrible tangent we just
but
went off.
But it literally was in his nose. He must have thought I was kidding. He must have laughed it off.
Yeah, he must have.
So this is what Eddie Trunk's trying to do to this kid. Like, I'm going to give you the finger as hard as I can because there's nothing else I can do about it, right? And he might have said a few words. He might have, you know, I don't know.
I don't remember. Yeah, he may have. Tough, or he may have just said, fuck you, back or some
yeah,
shit.
Yeah, right.
For all we know.
But, you know, he throws the finger back, and he looks like he wants... He's been holding it in the whole time he's making the introduction of the band.
Oh, yeah.
Right? He looks like he wants to cry. He looks like his panties are all bunched up, and he doesn't know what to do with himself, and he's all kinds of twisted up inside, and he just wants to let it out. And it looked like he was going to throw a hand at the kid, but it was just a finger.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Fast forward. Now, when this ends, Eddie doesn't leave the building. You've got more on that later.
Right.
Right? But I have to fast forward for a second, okay?
Of course.
Days after this Saigon Kick show, I would hear it or see it reported somewhere that Eddie Trunk had either pulled a hamstring or hurt his back. My recollection is a hamstring. Now, I didn't go researching it. We certainly wanted to cover it, you know, without getting ourselves in any trouble.
Of course.
But again, for my money, and according to the math in my head, I'm pretty sure a big old, bad old Eddie Trunk hiding behind a microphone all the time, kind of like I'm doing right now. I'm pretty sure a big old, bad old Eddie Trunk pulled his hamstring, tensing up to throw the middle finger in this kid's face.
Yep.
I mean, what kind of shape you got to be in for that?
Yeah. You know, right? You got to be in Eddie Trunk shape, apparently.
Right? I mean, his hair wasn't brushed. He looked like, what'd you say earlier? He looked like he...
A disheveled prick. No, he looked as though he had gone home after a long day of work, just wanting to re-the-fuck-lax for a minute, completely forgetting that he had an engagement to go to and host that evening, realizes, oh, shit, I'm going to be late, and runs right the fuck out of the house with shirt untucked.
Oh, well, I guess it's a perk of his line of work
that
he hangs out with rockers and it's informal. And he didn't look, to me, he didn't look presentable. He didn't look presentable. All right. I would have done a little bit better for Atlantic Records recording artists and world traveled, you know, Saigon Kick.
Yeah.
Right.
I agree.
He certainly didn't look as good as Jason Beeler or Chris McLernan, who was like, you know,
those guys,
tie and vest and whatever the heat. I mean,
those guys are sharply dressed all the time.
So he hurt himself flipping off some kid who got under his skin. And I think that's hysterical.
And fitting,
right? But he didn't leave the building. What did he do?
He hung out, naturally. I can only assume he hung out and observed, enjoyed the show, the set, which was fantastic. Again, by the way, guys, excellent show. And then was, you know, hanging out backstage afterwards, which we were fortunate enough to also hang out, because we really just stuck around like a couple of fucking groupies.
Oh, right. And to that end, keep in mind now, we had purchased VIP tickets to not only see the show, but to be in attendance for a meet and greet and a sound check beforehand. And we've covered that in detail on an older episode of this podcast before it was known as Thursday the 12th. We'll eventually tell you how to find those older shows. But we did four episodes on this concert, and we were very fortunate and delighted to be there for the whole experience. But there was this sort of VIP-ish room where the band could be on its own by itself, sort of backstage-ish at the studio at Webster Hall for a little while. Mm. And when the Saigon Kick set ended, Eddie and the band, and I suppose their VIPs, a different kind of VIPs than us, possibly, ended up in this space doing what these people do after a show. So, you know, Eddie continued to play host.
Yeah, and continued to, be a douche.
I guess, I don't know. At this point, I had said to Guy, go over there and find out if we can get in or something.
Yeah, and eventually we did get in. Eventually we did. And we got to appear as though we knew what the fuck we were doing.
Right, but you hung out over there for a little while. So what did you see and hear of Eddie in this room full of people who were trying to meet the band?
Oh, Ed was, talking to all kinds of people and this and that and whatever the fuck else was going on. I don't know. All I know is that I couldn't wait for the fucking guy to leave.
And it looked like, to me, from where I was, it looked like a lot of people felt that way.
Indeed. So, naturally, the smug prick that I can be, took it upon myself to drop somewhat subtle and maybe somewhat not so subtle hints to Ed that maybe it's time to get going. So I would, there'd be conversation going on, and then out of nowhere you'd hear me say something like, all right, Ed, All right. Good seeing you, Ed. Hey, Eddie, it was good seeing you. Great seeing you, Ed. We'll see you soon.
And I remember seeing him like double back to try to figure out who was talking to him or what. But it seemed to be working because now he was walking away from that. You almost got him to come back.
I almost overdid it and blew the whole thing.
But he looked confused, but he left. And that's when we made our way in and got to say our final goodnights to the band.
The band couldn't have been cooler. I mean, they were really nice guys.
But why a year and a half later, why are we talking about this Eddie Trunk incident? Because the other night on YouTube, I stumbled across something that said Eddie Trunk covers Controversy with Gene Simmons and the End of the Road tour. So if we haven't mentioned it already, and I'm pretty sure we did, Kiss goes on their final tour next year, and we're going to discuss that in the near future. But Eddie took it upon himself to spend quite a bit of time on a recent show talking about the fact that Paul Stanley and Gene Simmons of Kiss can sell portions of the live experience to fans who've already paid to see the live experience.
Yeah.
And as a Kiss fan, I have zero problem with that. What I don't understand is why this Kiss fan has such a problem with Kiss these days. Now, I get it. Some people, you know, don't need 12 different versions of the Greatest Hits CD. People don't need Kiss condoms or a Kiss casket.
Right.
Or a Kiss, waffle maker.
Oh, by the way, the Kiss casket, and again, it sounds like an absolutely unneeded, unnecessary novelty for someone to have, but for those of you who fancy yourselves as heavy metal fans, the late, great Dimebag Darrell of Pantera is, in fact, buried in a Kiss casket.
Oh, I didn't know that. I didn't know that. I thought you were headed for the, you know, doubles as a beer cooler.
No. He's buried.
Really?
He's buried in a Kiss casket, and he's also buried with. He was also a tremendous Van Halen fan, and for those who are Van Halen fans, whom my cousin here is not, I myself am. Eddie went ahead and, per Dimebag's request, buried the black and yellow. Ed's guitar that he recorded Van Halen 2 with.
With Dimebag?
Yes. So,
God bless Dimebag and his brother recently, too, right?
God bless them both,
So I didn't know he was buried in a Kiss casket. And I get that some folks just don't get that. I get it. But Eddie thought it was...
I'd like to be buried in a Kiss casket.
Eddie thought it was worth... So would I, and thank you for reminding me. I meant to say that. I hope to be myself someday. But he spent 15, 20 minutes at least talking about the fact that once you're in the Kiss concert or in attendance at the Kiss concert, you might have a chance to purchase the bass guitar that Gene plays on stage or the guitar that Paul Stanley plays or the... Or the torch that, oh, what the fuck are you going to do then now? Let me, you might get to, you might get to buy the torch that Gene lights on fire before he breathes fire. I mean, they're expensive items.
But, and understandably, but could you imagine just... Even having the opportunity, the possibility of owning one of these things, and again, yeah, super duper novelty, you know, whatever, and for the hugest of fans. But you know what? Fuck yous all. For the hugest of fans, these are things that we could only dream of having available to us. Let alone these items on this final end of the road tour.
Listen, if I had the money, I'd spend it. All right, I just don't understand. Why somebody who purports to be a Kiss fan takes every opportunity he can to bash them. Now, I understand he's tight with Ace, and Ace doesn't know if he's going to be included in this tour or not, and I also understand that at some point there may have been a falling out between Eddie Trunk and Paul Stanley, or maybe Paul Stanley didn't, you know, pay him the mind and attention he thought he deserved. But there's some sort of grudge there, and gosh damn it, I don't understand that. And as a result, I've got a grudge now.
In a nutshell, Trunk grew up a huge Kiss fan, like a lot of us did. Was a bigger fan of the original lineup than any of the other subsequent lineups. Nick Kiss has had several over the decades. He doesn't like Kiss moving on with other people wearing the makeup of the original members, essentially.
Right. Because he can call those shots, I guess. He's the fifth member of the band that got left out of making those decisions, I suppose. But that's about all we've got on that for now. We'll have to pick this up another time. We do thank you for listening to Thursday the 12th, our relaunched podcast, available on Instagram at the Thursday the 12th podcast, on Twitter at Thursday the 12th, at Thursday the 12th podcast at gmail.com, and of course, on Facebook in groups, facebook.com/groups/Thursday the 12th. This is just a little taste, a little sample of what you can expect on any one of the upcoming Thursdays in 2019. We thank you so much for joining us here tonight and being patient while we work on putting the show back together for you. My name is Rich Masotti.
And my name is Guy Monica.
And if you can hear the sound of our voices right now, then we are one. Thank you for listening. God bless. And we will talk to you next Thursday the 12th.
Okay, brother. Or did you already cut that off before I said, "Key brother"? Did you? Was it on there or no?
You gotta fucking keep talking, right?
Oh, what's that?
Shithole. That's all right. Let's see how that came out. Ah, yeah, that's good. Let's see.
Rewind it.
Rich Masotti. Commercials.
You pay your auto insurance premium every month on the dot. You're like the poster child for paying on time. And in return, for drivers like you with accident forgiveness and no late payments, Farmers won't raise your rates due to your first accident.
We are Farmers. Bum, 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 bum.
Picking a paint color for that special space in your home can be a real beast. Glidden paint comes to the rescue with only the colors people love to live with. Glidden gets you going. Fact, when you take Advil, you get relief right at the site of pain, wherever it is. Advil stops pain right where it starts. Relief doesn't get any better than this. Advil. With Clorox 2, we've turned removing stains into a science. Watch stains disappear right before your eyes. Remove 4 times more stains than detergent alone. Get new Clorox 2. At Jersey Mike's, we think every sub should have something to say about where it came from, about the people who made it, about how they made it. A sub can say it all without saying a single word. Jersey Mike's, a sub above.